This is the cream of the cream in terms of novelty in academic research. What are the key things coming out of the literature? But how do I identify gaps in the literature? What are you doing in the discussion section? Don't overclaim that you have done something that you actually didn't do. We always give credit where it is. We have to rethink everything that we knew up to this point. Anyone who says they have the perfect paper will be treated like a hypocrite because they are. I feel like I'm just repeating my literature review. What are the expectations when it comes to the discussion section and how is it different from the literature review? There are some similarities related to that, but there are some things that make the discussion more distinct from the literature review. And I'm going to spend some time explaining this to you. Once you master these things, then writing the discussion is going to become much easier. And separating the arguments that were already presented in the literature review from the arguments that you're going to present in the discussion section are going to be much easier. So with the literature review, the main thing that you have to keep in mind is that you are simply presenting the literature to us and building a narrative that is going to reveal what the shortcomings in the literature are, right? So we see less of your voice in the literature review and we see more of an effort to expose some of the issues with the current literature and therefore the gaps that you're going to present. So when I read literature reviews, I usually will give the advice to students, especially avoid what I call referencing deserts in your literature review. So a referencing desert in a literature review section is you having a whole paragraph without a single paper referenced, or even within a whole paragraph, having just one paper referenced is not good practice because then it means probably you don't have a synthesized literature review. So I have a video that I've already made to talk about what synthesis is in literature reviews and how you achieve that. But just to explain it briefly for the benefit of those who haven't seen it before, what a less advanced literature review looks like is this top part, right? Where people just say, something was said by Dube et al., something was said by SB 2004. So this is not a synthesized literature review. It's just an overview of the things that are in the literature. And these are your private notes. No one should ever get to see this because that's just you creating an overview of what is out there. So a synthesized literature review looks a lot like this. Let me fold this so that it's out of the way. This is a synthesized literature review. With synthesized literature reviews, you create that narrative that tells us, you know, what are the key things coming out of the literature? So you have a group of authors actually agreeing on a particular thing, and maybe you have another set of authors who slightly go in a different direction, or maybe add a bit of knowledge or insight into this, and maybe someone who takes an entirely different direction. So synthesis in literature reviews is actually you taking this very linear view to the literature and trying to paint a canvas that shows us, okay, so what are the general conversations and what is going on? And we can see where there's alignment and where there might be contradictions or exceptions that we would like to explore. So with literature reviews, just because you are trying to give us some insight into what is known and what the shortcomings are, you cannot afford to have what I call referencing deserts. Every paragraph should really be dense with the literature. The only exception maybe is your opening paragraph, because usually you will say in this section, these are the things that I'm going to do. Maybe I'm going to unpack some concepts and then I'm going to introduce some of the key variables and then also discuss some of the key issues in the literature. So for that, you don't have to have any literature cited because you're telling us what you're going to do. And then the last paragraph also, you could get away with not citing any literature because it's you summarizing what you have just told us and pulling everything together into a research framework that is going to inform your research. To get more information on the literature review, I have two YouTube videos that do an amazing job. So the first one actually tells you how do you write a great literature review and what are the key considerations that you have to make that are going to determine things like how you structure the literature, how much time you spend on certain variables, and how you link them up in the write-up of that literature review. So this video has everything that you need in order to write a literature review for your paper. And then next to that, people still ask, but how do I identify gaps in the literature? So I have a video that talks about some four of the best ways to identify gaps in the literature that, in my view, actually sometimes lead to the best contributions in terms of addressing those gaps. That's the first part. The literature review has much less of your voice and more of a show and tell of what is going on in the literature and ends with a so what. So what are the key issues that we would like to understand, pull together into a conceptual framework that is going to guide the research process? Now you go through the research process, you get your results, and you're in the discussion section. What are you doing in the discussion section? So there's a particular structure that I adopt that I have found to be quite useful, and it helps to minimize the repetition, so repeating yourself in the discussion section. So what I usually will do with my discussion section is that when I first start out, of course, I might say something about, oh, this was the overall goal of the research. This is what I set out to do. And then I'm going to say in the second paragraph, here are the findings that I get that align with what is already known. So I did not create any new knowledge, but I was able to replicate existing knowledge through my own research process. So giving that acknowledgement that what you have found in this instance is not new is very important, because in academic writing, we're very fussy about claims of novelty. So don't overclaim that you have done something that you actually didn't do. We always give credit where it is due. And then the second thing that this acknowledgement does for you is that it helps to legitimize the other parts of your work that might come later. So if you replicate some of the known knowledge through your own research process, then I am more inclined to believe that what you're going to present as new next is actually also solid work. I can trust that those results are valid, even if they would be new. And then the third thing that it does, which is what Croza was asking about, is that it helps you to not repeat yourself too much. So within one paragraph, you can already make the necessary acknowledgements of what's already known. And maybe some of it was already in your literature review. Some of it may not have been in your literature review because you had not thought to capture it. But we know it's not new knowledge, and you're able to point us to the references where they actually bring those things up. That's it. That's the first part. Then you put that out of the way. Now, everything else that is left in terms of your findings becomes new knowledge. But then you have to qualify the ways in which this knowledge is new, right? So some knowledge might be new in the sense that you nuance something, right? So whereas we always understood this particular phenomenon in a particular way, through this research, I'm able to maybe show the mechanisms through which these things happen in a more fine-grained way. So that is a contribution that is new. Sometimes the newness is in the fact that whereas other people have said A, I actually find B. So I find something that contradicts the extant literature, and then I have to spend some time on showing that this contradiction is a legitimate finding, in which case we have to rethink everything that we knew up to this point. And then I could also say this is new in the sense that it was completely omitted. No one has spoken about it before. So this is very new knowledge. This is as high as you can go. This is the cream of the cream in terms of novelty in academic research, because you found something. No one was looking for it, but it's going to be a game changer for the discipline in terms of how we are going to advance knowledge in this particular field. So this is the way that I would say you have to do it. This is the way that has worked for me. And then in addition to talking about this newness, one of the most important things in your discussion is bringing things back into a theoretical landscape, right? So it's more than just telling us what is new, but it's also about providing explanations for why you find those things, right? So what are the explanations that lead to these new findings? In which case, most times I'm going to have a set of propositions. So I propose based on these findings that A is related to B, or A causes B, or A causes three, it causes C through B. But I have to be able to specify quite concretely what the whys, the explanations are for what I actually find. And this is where we usually will also bring in other literature. So it may be the literature that we already reviewed. It may be literature that we initially hadn't looked at. I like to even check literature that's outside of my own discipline, because some of the phenomena that I study in my discipline are already well understood in some areas. So in the past, for example, I've looked into political science literature to try to understand humanitarian operations in political crisis settings, because the political aspect is going to be very strong. So whereas in my discipline of supply chain management, they may never talk about the political aspect at all, the political science literature might already offer up the insights that I need to be able to explain and justify the explanations that I'm offering up. Another important component that you have to address within the discussion is also being able to say, or being able to show, that what you are offering up as an explanation is likely a legitimate explanation. So we normally go through a process of eliminating other possible explanations, right? So why are you calling it this and not calling it that? And that's usually about showing how what you have done is different from what is already known, and what it adds to that existing knowledge in order to qualify as new, and what sort of arguments you are presenting to show that it's not just new, but it's also valid. Because creating new knowledge all the time is quite easy, but creating valid knowledge that people can build on in future research, that's a harder task. And that's what you have to demonstrate in your discussion section. So when I have done that, this is probably my section 6.2 or 6.1 of the discussion. I'm going to then spend some time on talking about, now that I have shown you this new information and I have given you some insight into how it is new and how it is valid, I am going to talk about what the implications are for us going forward in terms of how we do research. So maybe I can say, in the future, anyone who does research in this area must consider these factors. Otherwise, whatever knowledge they generate is not going to be that valuable. Or maybe we need to work with these types of methods more, because they help us to uncover certain things that we have not been able to until now because of the types of methods that we were using. But these implications for research are usually a very generic way of sort of talking to the field about how you need to think about research in this area in the future based on this knowledge that I've just created with my own process. And then you also, within the same section, usually will talk about the implications for practice, because the practical contributions, the societal value, becomes more important in a lot of disciplines now. So you are going to have to say, okay, so if a manager were to pick up my work, what sort of things can they learn from this work that is going to help them in making decisions? So maybe how do they think in a more nuanced way about the problems that they've got? How do they use resources more efficiently based on this information that we have? So maybe you say, if you face this situation, you don't need to apply this expensive solution because you're not going to get a better result than going for the cheapest option, for example. But you really have to link concretely the insights that you present in section 6.2 to what it means for decision makers and how they can improve their decisions based on what you have found. And then after that, they will be, at least in my, in the way that I approach this, I also always like to spend some time talking about then the research limitations and what can be done in future research. Actually, we all have to talk about research limitations. So section 6.4, is it 6.4 now? Yes. So 6 or 6.4. Yeah. So section six, you just say, this is what this research set out to do. This is what it finds to be. This is what it finds that already aligns with the literature. 6.1, you're going to say, here are the things that are new. I'm going to qualify the ways in which they are new. So maybe they offer a bit more nuance, or they contradict what was known, or they were missed completely. So this is something that's completely new. And you're going to spend time within that section eliminating alternative explanations and actually showing that your arguments are valid, and preferably also putting together